Is it okay?
I
Okay.
Because I mean, it was changing. It was always needed to be updated.
My name is Vikrant Rathore, and today I will be talking about building next generation API using Python, PostgresQL, JWT, and LXC. Right. Hopefully you have spent your evening here. Maybe you might find something useful in this talk. All right. So my self-introduction is already there, so no need to talk a lot about it. Basically, I am running my startup in Singapore, Roka Technology, in which I'm trying to build one multi-channel commerce platform. Okay. So instead of giving this one, I will directly come back to the session how I'm creating this app. Now, how many of you are aware of Python? Python, all of you. You must have programmed in Python, right? I will talk to you about why I choose Python for my works. That would be the way I would start. So since it's Python, right? The very first reason I chose Python was because very important thing was it's a pseudocode which runs. So Python looks like a pseudocode, but it runs, right? Here, Control X, Control F, API craft. Here is, it's just addresses. This one, right? It's just a simple pseudocode. I can just print it, right? It would run. It's a pseudocode which runs. That was one feature. The next reason why I choose Python was, instead of putting it in a presentation, this fits my thinking and my philosophy. Beautiful is better than ugly. This is PEP 20, if you are aware of Python. And it fits my brain very, very clearly. I especially like, you know, the one where explicit is better than implicit. I had a decision to make which programming language to choose in 2003, when I was starting building one new app. 2003 or 2004, at that time, Ruby on Rails was just starting. They had one small book out at that time. It was not even 1.0 version. And I bought that book, which was written by David Hanson. I started reading that book. The problem with me was that in that one, you use an active record pattern, and Python, you know, your active record pattern automatically picks up the objects based on your MySQL schema, right? A lot of magic. I did not like it. At that time, I got introduced to Django, where explicit is better than implicit. So all models were defined. That was one of the reasons. And since then, I picked up Python. I did not give it up. Since then, I've been working with it. I think all of you are aware of this PEP 20, right? And that's one of the reasons. Second reason I chose is a lot of people have problems with performance in Python. I never had it. Because whatever is performance optimized code, I can interface it with C. And I can work it. Like the way they have done in machine learning using NumPy arrays, and using a lot of scientific libraries, I started using them. The most important thing for me was, another one was, readability counts. And looking at the code, I can read and I can understand. Because they have a very explicit rule of white spaces. Many people don't like it, they hate it, but for me, I always liked it. Because obviously, now if you are following Golang, I don't know how many of you are doing Golang development, but if you are working in Go, they also have GoFMT tool. But nobody questions that why it has to be same format for everybody. In Python also, because editors can take care of your four space rules, it can you know, format your code, so you don't need to do much with this one. Okay, that was the reason I chose Python for my work, right? Then Okay. Then my second question was, why PostgreSQL? Okay. The first time I started working with PostgreSQL was 1996, when it was just a pure C library. And second reason I chose, when MySQL became very popular, PostgreSQL was still not popular. I still choose PostgreSQL because it was SQL 92 compliant. So the queries which I can write, inner joins at that time were there, outer joins were not there, then they came left outer joins. They keep on enhancing their features later on and bring SQL 92 conformance. Second reason I chose was, it has been constantly developing. The clusters have been okay. It again fits my brain. That was my reason for choosing PostgreSQL. But today there are a lot of other reasons to choose PostgreSQL, because today they have a very native JSONB support, which is as performant as MongoDB. Okay, I use UUID types, because which are default built-in type, instead of using ID, an integer ID or auto increment fields. Now I use UUID so that I can give everyone a unique identity in my system. Okay, that was the reason I choose my. Then, now I come to what is JWT and why JWT? So how many of you are aware of JWT? Okay, so you must already know what is JSON Web Token, right? The reason I choose JSON Web Token instead of relying on OAuth interfaces and other libraries, because in JWT token, I can make my applications stateless. Stateless in a sense that if I have 100 API servers, right, they can work independently. Second thing I choose JWT is because I'm authenticating a person using encryption keys. I don't do any database lookups. I take away all those calls away. I'll show you in the code later on. Basically, I have an example code which I have done on that one, the JWT part. And the payload is very small for JWT. When you send along with HTTP, the payload is very, very small. It's not very big. I send it as a header, or you can send it as a body if you want to send it as a body. The last part come back to is LXD. Why LXD, not Docker? I used to work with jails before, Solaris jails or BSD jails, if you call it. And in Linux also has jails in the old days, chroot actually. They had chroot in which you can, you know, change root, and then all the processes running in that change root belongs to that root. They don't go beyond the boundaries of those roots. All right. In 1999, actually 2001, we launched one server based on basically exactly the same virtual servers using before OpenVZ, just using jails and chroot. I was familiar with this. When Docker came up, I started working with Docker. The problems I faced in Docker was, I did not like working with Dockerfile and supervisor D or run it, because I'm relearning the whole process again. And normally, in LXC containers, if you have used LXC containers before, anybody has used LXC containers, it already supported init scripts. So I do not need to rewrite those supervisor daemons, or I do not need to rewrite using runit or systemd. That was one reason. Then whenever I need to troubleshoot or log, I always had my own Docker images with SSH, so that I can go into the Docker images, sometimes check the logs, because otherwise I need to have a centralized logging system, another system to maintain it. So that was one of the reasons. Now, how many of you are aware of LXD? Only one, right? Okay, when Docker came up, what Docker provided you is an API using the underlying C groups and jails to implement a container, right? In the first version of Docker, they also use LXC as the underlying machinery. But later on, in order to build takeaway, in order to enhance the feature, why I do not still did not understand their reason why they bifurcate. So I wrote a blog post on it, actually, that when they get, and then LXC 1.0 was launched. In that one, there were three main advantages which came up. One was it supported unprivileged containers. Unprivileged containers means you can run it as a user. All right, so you don't have to have the main container accessing your kernel resources, because you can restrict the user processes by user security, first thing. Second thing was that it provided, it worked, I do not need to work with any initialization scripts, all worked seamlessly as I will do with any bare metal or with a Ubuntu server, or with Red Hat, or with any other server. Now, after LXC build up, they build up one daemon called LXD. LXD provide similar REST API as Docker to manage your containers using LXC. LXD can help you build your own cloud of containers. What Docker can do, actually LXD can also do. Then LXD consists of three different things, as you know. It's a system-wide daemon, a command line tool LXC, and Noah Compute LXD. You're aware of OpenStack already, right? So LXD has Noah Compute plugin with which you can actually launch your, instead of launching a VM based on KVM, this one, you can launch LXD-based VMs. And this can be managed directly if you do not want to go into OpenStack and everything, right? You can just use your pure plain LXD APIs. They are very simple, simple REST APIs, which you can use to connect it. The beauty of that one was what, you know, suppose I have an application. I have an application. I created my application. I created my container. I frozen my container, correct? I frozen my container. Now, the first step is I create an image out of that container and put it on a repository. So whoever wants to use it can directly call that image, right? Right? If you go in a Docker solution, you need to use some central repository or some outside repository. But in LXD already has a built-in support of those images as an image server. And you can restrict it because it's hosted in within your own premises. Your images are not accessible to people not authorized to use it, right? And then you can launch as many containers as you want from that image. The amount of time it takes is the same as Docker because still it's a container. Maybe you run a bit more services than a Docker, but the overhead is still not that heavy. That's the reason I chose LXD container. This is all. So now I will come back directly to applications. Okay, all of you have worked in Python, so you know already the virtual env and everything, right? Yeah, sure. It's a small, right? Command plus. Yeah, it's.
I thought it was because I didn't take contacts, but if you notice that it's too small, then probably it's more than that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Actually, I don't have a mirroring, so it's. Actually, I cannot see on my screen. Okay. 720p, right? It's okay. Perfect. Okay, perfect. Okay. Okay. Here you go, okay? So, what I did is I created one Python app using Flask. How many of you are aware of Flask? Flask is a micro framework. And I'm using this micro framework with blueprint and factory pattern. I don't know if you know application factory pattern. It makes the code modular, just in a short way, right? So you can write your own modules and this one, right? I go with microservices architecture in Flask, but I still try to have, conceptually similar APIs in one single module. I do not try to separate it into separate microservices. This is my design, but you can prefer your choices, okay? So I have developed this simple app, which is showing you how I am implementing authentication using JWT and how I can use it across my multiple apps, right? Now, this app consists of just a very simple So this is the config file for the Flask app, which is this one, okay. This is the actual kauth API code. What this does is very simple. This kauth API helps me to set up the app, just set up the app. I do not write app code here. The app code will be in authapi.py here. So here actually I wrote my code, right? Now I used bcrypt for encrypting, because before allowing user to get a token, you still want a login and password from the user for your any app, right? That would be the first thing. So you need to create an API for login, correct? Obviously I have created it beforehand, so here I'm running the app at 127.0.0.py. Okay. Okay. I have a tester one and tester, okay? Sorry. I haven't started the server, right? Here. Once I logged in, I got my access token, correct? This is how the access token looks like. All right, and my application also needs user information for profile information on details, right? Now, once I got this access token, I do not need to do any database lookups. Here is the create token code, which I wrote, right? Precisely create token code. Here I'm doing, since yours was about to talk about JWTs, I did not cover it in detail, sorry. Yeah. I remember you were saying that you will cover up, so I did not cover up. So I did not explain IAT role. But the beauty of JWT token was that the basic problem in your application when you want to do authentication is, first thing is, you need to authenticate whether this user is a valid user, correct? And second problem you always try to solve is whether this user has an authorization to use that resource or not. These are the two problems you want to solve in your authentication, right? What I have done is, in this one, I pass on, in the payload, the user name and the role. All right, and so this is an encrypted token, all right? This encrypted token is going to the client. Client doesn't need to know which is the user, what is the role. He just need to send me back this encrypted token, And based on that, I can determine what is his level. And based on that, I can give him an access. Any doubts here? Now, I have done a create code. Here, I do is valid token. I'm using PyJWT library directly to validate the token. All right, create the token. And now, the beauty of Python here comes here. What did I do? It is, I wrote one Docker router, require valid token. And whatever resource I want to restrict, I just include that decorator. Yeah, see here. Here's a require valid token, right? Right? So, I try to call this API, right? Correct? Now, this is not the, this is the new token, right? Now, the problem with JWT token is, since there is no central authority issuing these tokens or keeping track of these tokens, right? If somebody gets this token, he will have unlimited access to your resources, correct? The way to solve this problem is using timeouts. Because as soon as I introduce centralized authority like OAuth, it becomes a single point of failure again. So if I scale my application, then I need to scale those central authority again. So for truly stateless 12-factor app, what I do it is basically I use this one. You can do another thing to restrict it. Currently, I'm using, you know, symmetric algorithm. HS512 byte algorithm, right? So I do not check for public-private key, right? If I want to restrict client usage, I can issue him a client certificate, and only the client which is encrypting his data with that client will get access to my information. So I can have public-private key also using JWT tokens. That is another way to implement restriction. I find it's much easier for me to scale and work. And what did I do? It is basically, here token, as I said to you, this is the old token, not the new token, correct? Okay, for your information, the command line utility I'm using is HTTPy. It's again a Python client, which gives you a very beautiful overview of client. Instead of using curl, it's again simple. Now, your question will again be coming. This is just purely running on my desktop, correct? How would I scale it? And how JWT helps me to make my application stateless, correct? Right? That would be the question, right? This can be done by any other application as well, right? How I make my application stateless is, first thing is, for authenticating the user, I'm not relying on any lookups. I'm not maintaining any sessions. I'm not maintaining any cookies. You send your header with a part of HTTP header with a bearer token, I'm fine with it. I don't need anything else other than that. OAuth which is can also do the same. OAuth can also do the same, but if you use OAuth, then you need to maintain an OAuth server somewhere down the line. OAuth has its own advantages, disadvantages, whatever you call it, actually. And for every accesses, it will need to connect to that server and check whether it is valid or not valid, okay? But in JWT, all the code is only within your application itself, right? Now, suppose I build one microservices, which I call it as authentication app, authentication. All right, so I have one microservice. I created a separate Python app called products, which gives products, right? Now, the only link between these two is only one thing, which is secret key. As long as both of them use the same secret key, they can decode and validate the token. And this key setup will be done when I initially set up the application one time. This is basically a simple microservices using Python. This code took me around 5 hours to write. Actually, to write everything in this one. There is one more service I wrote. The problem is, for your token, right? For your token, you want to give a timeout of like 5 minutes or 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Actually, I have defined here JWT timeout. Timeout here. All right. I can change this timeout settings and I can send it, right? But before this timeout, do you want your client to again log in and register? Log in to get another token? No. What you want to do it is basically that he sends you another API request, renew token. What it sends you? Renew token with my old token, which is a valid one. So if I receive an old valid token and renew token, I will get in return a new token, which I can reuse in my application. So this way you can safeguard your application. The only access which somebody can get access to your application if by chance you lose your token will be like 5 minutes or whatever timeout you set up. Okay, what I did was, okay, I developed this Python app, everything. I can show you one place where I wrote a here you can see, these are the two different apps. Okay. One is the product API, where I put all the microservices related to product API. In one, I put all the auth APIs. And now here, if you see product API config.py, the token I'm using is the same. And since I'm using the same secret key, you can use JWT across your app. Yes, please go ahead.
How do you, in a live application,
right,
when you keep the keys,
yes,
you can't keep them source code because they end up in the version control system otherwise.
No, that's where I try to tell you that this key, which is there, I do not keep it in version control. When I set the application, I'm writing Ansible scripts to deploy my application, okay? And when I deploy the Ansible script, actually I created one utility called create token, create secret key. So it will run that, create the secret key, and change this when it deploys.
So your Ansible script changes the source code?
Changes the deployment secret key. Because secret key has to be changed, and all the apps should be same. And you don't do it in your version control, you do it in your deployment scripts. And you run a program to generate a secret key on the server. I don't even generate it here, I generate it on the server. So what happens is, why I use Ansible, there is a reason, and why I use LXD, because Ansible is much easier to work with to bring your machine to a particular state, right?
So
I did not create all those examples here, but it's pretty easy to do actually. So the secret key, which is on the production machine, is entirely completely different from what is there. It is just completely two different things.
Just read from the environment.
Because this was one of the biggest problem I you know, when I was discussing with my development team, I told them specifically, no keys, no password should ever be in your version control except the test data which you run.
So there is of course a problem that that's why people use Ansible Vault, I assume, that you may have a whole set of servers that need to share the key, if not the security key, then at least the public key, to make sure that it was produced from a given secret.
Right. Yeah, what I do, okay? I want to deploy an app, right? What I will do it is, okay, we come back to that topic right away. I was saying, okay, this all what you saw was...
So you may have like one server that allows you to log in, that produces the token, but you have 10 other servers, and you want to check that the token is actually original.
For that one, what I do it is, I show you how would I do that part. This is, I'm starting a VM on my system, okay? I'm using Vagrant because I'm using LXD, and LXD only works on Linux. Okay, come on. Okay. Okay. Now, this is my, this is my production host. As I'm using, as I said to you, what I'm using pure LXD, right? I'm using pure LXD server. So what I will do is LXC list. I have stopped this containers, right? These containers can be created automatically by Ansible script. So just for the demo, I'm just showing you this one. When I create these containers, I keep a copy. So for app server, I create one container, which is API craft app one. Sorry, you cannot see it. Actually, I can make it bigger. Is it okay now? Okay. These are the two containers you see right there. Initially, I created these two containers using an Ansible script. From these two containers, here I set up the DB and my private keys and every keys in these containers. And now, these containers of our production, right? I created images out of this container, which is LXC list images, okay? Sorry. LXC. You see here. So you see the images? Here you have API craft app and API craft. These are converting these containers into an image. And now from this image, I can launch new containers. And every container which I'm launching will be using the same key which was there in that container. So even if I run millions of these containers, it will still have the same key. I move it to hundreds of different, deploy to hundreds of different servers, still it will have the same key.
So you have basically a father container that has the secret key and then you put everything.
But to create this container, the key is created dynamically using Ansible script. So, you can do as many as you want, right? Now, okay, now I'm running this server, I see LXC. Now I divided. Currently, everything I was running on one machine. Now I divide it into two containers. One is the DB container, another is the API container, correct? So, okay. These are the two containers already started, correct? Right? Now, the basic problem with me always was sometimes I like to go inside the container and check things. Sometimes, okay? So I use SSH jump host. I don't know if you used it, but I use SSH jump host to log into containers to check my things, okay? So here I will go here. Now I'm running server locally, 127.0.0.1.115, right? Now I'm sending an API to my VM, which I'm running here, all right? And VM is getting this information from this API server. So my VM is the front. My VM, which is the physical host, whatever I can have a bare metal, or it can be a Google Cloud VM, or it can be Amazon Cloud VM, whatever it is. That's the front. I'm running Nginx on it. What I'm running? I'm running Nginx on it. And then I created a load balancer inside it, which is now connecting to my API server behind. And then API server in turn is connecting to DB, which is here actually, which is, I think it's here. Okay. The IP address which I used is of this VM. You can check. Yeah, this one, 172.128.3. And if you look at here, it's the same. 172.8.3, all right? You can see here, I have decided upstream backend. I define only one server right now, correct? Here, and then I'm just proxy pass to this one. Sorry, upstairs. Here, proxy pass backend. Correct? But if you see above, you would notice one more thing here is that still I am forwarding my request to port 80 of my container. I'm not using any specific port. I'm still transferring to port 80 of my container because in container I'm running another Nginx. To forward it to this one. I can use directly any API server also, it's up to you, all right? But why I do Nginx is because I can do throttling, I can put Redis server in between, I can do a lot of things with that one, caching and a lot of other things. This was one of the basic feature of RESTful APIs, layered systems, if you know. And this is following that layered architecture. Now, here we see, currently, I'm running one API server, correct? Let's launch a new API server because I haven't tested it myself yet. I just created it home and came here. So let's create one more API server from the container, run the server, and let's check whether we can load balance it and we can still respond to upstream or not. LXC launch craft app. This is the image name, API craft app, and API craft app 2. I give the container name as 2. It will take some time, sorry. Yeah. Okay, done.
May I have one question?
Yes, please.
I'm interesting in scaling using the containers. Can you have somehow speed it up if you are making like tens of containers?
I'm just doing the experiment in front of you that I created one container, now I'm creating second container. What I will do is I will set it up in the front-end engines. Now I got the IP address, right? So what I will be doing is I need to do one thing, because right now I did not convert my Flask into systemd service yet. Because if I go into production, I will convert it into systemd. It will automatically start when my container starts or stop. But I haven't converted it into systemd service right now. So what I will be doing is basically is starting the service manually. But you can assume it can be done automatically, yeah? So this is okay, right? Now I'm going to app 2, correct? It will accept the keys. I'm locked on. Using the same keys. You have seen? I did not change anything. I'm using the same old key as I'm using for that container. Because I wanted to automate it using Ansible scripts. And Ansible script should be, obviously I put a secret key, but if you deploy through Ansible scripts, you will not put any secret key there.
Basically, you first use Ansible to create containers, and then you go inside the container and set it up there.
I set up all the container using Ansible script. I can do that without touching it. I mean, like the Docker, you create a Docker, right? I can create this whole deployment using pure, the container which is created currently, right? I have created a container, right?
How do you solve the problem of dependencies that you need inside the container?
Already solved beforehand. In the deployment script. See, currently I had one container, right? I had another image, only image, which I created from this ready-made container, right? I launched this container, it has all the dependencies already built in. I don't have to change it.
Yeah, that I know, but you may, the dependencies may change, or you may use the mother image before you generate the secret key. Do you also do it with Ansible?
Okay.
Or do you do it on your own host and then you copy it to some central container register?
Okay, my strategy would be, if I'm deploying an LXD container, right? If I'm using LXD container, if I want to use it like Docker, what I would do it is, if I want to use it like, if I want to use it like Docker, I will do very simple. I will write an Ansible script to create the complete image. What I will do? I will write an Ansible script to create a Docker image and save it. And then in the next step, I will launch the containers using LXD's APIs. Is this clear?
Yeah.
Right? Now, suppose...
Now I get it.
So in that case, if my new dependencies come up, now in this one, the beauty is what, you know? The beauty of LXC is here, before updating anything on LXC, I can take a snapshot. A pure snapshot. If you're using BTRFS or ZFS, the file system, if I'm using BTRFS or ZFS file system, what I can do is I can create Delta backups very on a regular basis. The performance is really great, actually. I have tried it on the production machines.
So for practical use of a lot of containers, you need to first have a virtual machine with BTRFS or ZFS. Then on top of it, you do all the things.
No, on the host, on one single host. You don't need to bother about multiple hosts, but on a one single host, you can just...
But if you want to deploy it with more than one virtual machine...
Oh, it doesn't...
You have something in the cloud, you just want to shuttle it.
Okay, you want to do it, like, suppose, give you an example. You created one LXD container image for your app, correct? Is this clear?
Yeah.
Okay, you have
created... I have it on my computer.
You have it on your computer. Actually, this image can be transferred to any cloud as is using LXD clone. Using LXD APIs. And actually, using LXD APIs, I can do live migration of a running container from one machine to another machine. The only thing which you need to be taking care of is that the LXD versions they are using on the destination and this one is the same. Because it uses CRIU. Not the main topic. Is basically, you're running an app here on your laptop and you want to move it to production. Actually, you can do live migrate to your Google Cloud or Amazon Cloud if you want to do that.
Okay, so that's a problem because especially on some cloud services, you have pretty old Linux version. So you need to basically have the same Linux version on all your cloud services.
No, they have a minimum kernel. Minimum kernel. The minimum kernel version which supports CRIU.
Okay, so we don't really need to have the same version.
Yes, but the CRIU support and there's a minimal kernel version which is required for supporting CRIU. So that kernel version you need to be bothering about. Obviously, I am a fan of bare metal. I'm not a fan of cloud that much. No, there are reasons for it, but that's another topic to talk.
You say that you also have containers or virtual machine on bare metal. So the issue is the same. Somebody asks you to deploy your API on bare metal that they own, and they don't want to upgrade operating system.
No, because, for me, I did not look into Kubernetes or Mesos or, Docker Swarm just because of one reason. First thing was, for me, personally, I'm talking about myself, I did not look at it because using an LXD, I can already create 100, 200 machines cluster by writing simple Python programs, and which I understand very well, which fits in with my team very well, 200. And for a startup like us, when we are starting, I'm not going to 2,000 servers in one night or 3,000 servers in one night. I was very practical when I was thinking about these systems, right? I need Mesos or Kubernetes when I go to data center scales where I have 3 or 4 data centers, 2 data centers where I create pods and all those things, but I'm not that size. So I thought from practical point of view, and with LXD, we can do all the experiments on our laptop. And then once the image is finalized, we can just push this image wherever we want. And as long as we have the backup of this image, we will never lose anything. Okay, I was coming back to you, API server 2. Here, for you, here I logged into the API server 2. Now there are 2 servers, right? 2 containers running, right? Here I will go to example app, auth API, okay. source://bin/activate, okay. And here I run Python. Sorry. Okay. It's running. And now, what I will do it is, for my load balancer, every time I load, I need to change my load balancer configuration, right? So what I will do it is, I will go to my load balancer. This is my load balancer, which is the main machine. Okay. So the new one is 10.1.126, right? Okay, and I restarted my Nginx, right? Now, when I call this API, which server it will go to, I don't know yet. It is still going to the old server, not to the new server. You see? It is automatically redistributing, automatically load balance. If one goes down, another will still be up. If one goes down, another will be up. I scaled my app right here in itself without doing much work. And why? I set up the container only one time. I created an image, and then I can deploy it to as many places as I want. Now I can do this. You know why? Because I use JWT. If I'm using sessions, then I have a lot of problems because I need to have sticky sessions that this session is connected to which server, and then I can only connect to that app server. But in this case, since JWT requests can be handled by both in the same way, I don't bother where the request goes to. But you must have noticed there is still a problem here. I don't know whether you know it, and which I'm trying to solve all the time is, still, it doesn't take away the need to have a clustered database. It doesn't take away that need. You still need to have it. So using Python, right? Using JWT, using PostgreSQL, because backend database, it is using PostgreSQL. Again, if you look at my code, now here the beauty of this one is, Control X, Control F. I will show you one very good one part in this one is projects, API craft, example app, auth API, models.py. Okay. When you're working with JSON APIs, why you would use protocol buffers? Why you will use protocol buffers? Can anyone answer? If you worked on any protocol. The reason protocol buffers offers a lot of advantage because it offers a type system. And once you, the generated code will always confirm. So the client will not send wrong data. And even if you receive wrong data, you can already validate through the library. You don't need to write a code for it. Correct? Obviously, I'm working with JSON schema, right? My biggest problem is I need to still validate the JSON schema, generate the responses to the customer, which is properly generated, this one. Now, what I do is, first thing is, I create it. Obviously, I need to represent this object in the database, right? Obviously, if I'm using MongoDB, I can put the object itself. But here, suppose as an example, I am using, this is the user model, simple, okay. It is using ID, username, and I'm only storing password hash. I'm not storing password itself. You know it, this is the best practice, that you only store password hashes, you never store passwords in your databases. And this password hash also is using bcrypt with 10 rounds minimum. So that it is very difficult, even if you get the raw data, it's very hard to reverse engineer the data. All right? And in bcrypt, I think it is advisable. All of you are aware of bcrypt, right? Why to use bcrypt? Because in bcrypt, the key goes along with the encrypted key. So even if you are able to hack one password, you will not be able to see other passwords. Because each one is a separate key. Obviously, I'm using I don't know whether you know this one. I'm using Python uuid.uuid4 functions to create a unique UUID automatically, which is the default. So the way you use auto increment field in the database, instead of that, I'm using auto increment UUID field. This guarantees that even if I separate the users across multiple servers, they won't collide. So I can scale my apps without, so you know, when you want to scale your app, you design from ground up in that way.
I have a question. You mentioned about schema.
Yes. Yes, this is the question comes up. Now, this part already makes sure that if I'm using any of the Python APIs to write data to the database, it already checks. This is the model which defines the constraints. All right. But this only checks when from Python code I'm writing to the DB. There is another part when I'm receiving the request, there is a JSON information coming to me. Correct? For that also, there are two ways I can do. I use Python Marshmallow library. It's a human library. It works like I define the schema and then I pass on my request data to that schema and it will automatically validate and give me errors. And okay, I will show you. I think I have it. Here is the schema I created. You see here? Right? You get an error, right? Length must be between 62 and 36. You know why? This comes from here. So what did I do? It is, obviously, I can generate this schema automatically from the DB. I can use a Marshmallow library to automatically convert my database, the model which I defined for defining user to use my schema, but I don't do it. I said you, I follow Python's second part, explicit is better than implicit. Explicit is better than implicit. So I really explicitly defined it. And I think this was it for today, actually, what I wanted to discuss about. Any questions on this one? Please.
Just now you mentioned the protobuf, why you use the question, just now you mentioned, actually is the question you raised just now.
Protobuf,
you use this, what's the reason?
Oh, first problem with protocol buffers for me was, okay, when I try to work with protocol buffers, right? Yeah. When the developer works with the protocol buffer, because you want productivity, in a startup, the speed to market is also important along with accuracy. Both the things are important, right? I wanted that whatever JSON request and response they are coming, they should be validated. Okay. Second thing was that protocol buffers, they say it's a binary format. So it offers, the space advantage. I don't know if you worked with Korba. I worked with Korba in the old days. Tau, if you worked on Ace Tau framework, you know, they had one time that whole software will become assembled one. I don't know whether you read that theory in the old days, Tau. All the telecommunication systems are based on those Korba protocol. Korba was binary protocol. It was very difficult to debug, very difficult to understand. So we standardized on JSON. We said, okay, don't go with protocol buffers. Maybe it's very new, very shiny. But still, JSON works. The space we found out is basically, you remember I put Nginx in the front, right? Nginx in the front. When I send the response through Nginx, I zip it. I use gzip compression, like the web page. And it has been already very advanced. Actually, you can compress really very compact. So the difference between a compressed JSON and protocol buffers is very little. Second part is, I show you one very important part, which I did was, I was working in a domain where the schema is constantly evolving. It is never fixed. Because, you know, I was working in consumer product data. If you take one single camera and look at all the parameters of that camera and go country by country, the amount of feature and descriptions required in each of them is different. Right? So you need a flexibility of schema. If I use protocol buffers, my problem comes up is this, I cannot be flexible. All right. And here, I show you one. You see, this is my product schema. Very simple. Everything is a JSONB column. Correct? It's a pure JSONB column where I need to use. Where I need to use relationship, I use relationship, but I use JSONB. But this inside has schemas, JSON schemas. So what did I use is, I created marshmallow models of this schema so that still it conforms to a standard. But marshmallow is malleable. It can be changed by programming at runtime. And that's the reason, you know, I choose this one over protocol buffers because of the domain of the problem. If I'm building some telecom system where the interfaces are very clean and clear, I might go with protocol buffers. Any questions from anybody, please?
Just as you mentioned about cluster database, have you tried using like PostgreSQL database to become a cluster, like using pgpool, that kind of
tool? Pgpool, you cannot have master-master. You can have read-only replicas. So your read queries can be distributed among cluster, but write queries has to go somewhere, correct? And if you want to have read-write master-master cluster, you will use Citus or Bocardo. Citus, Bocardo, and there is one more, Tungsten. So there are three or four solutions available for that one. But Citus data, if you go to Citus data, they have an open source version where you can spread your cluster into master-master cluster.
And for your DB containers, right, did you attach your volume into somewhere else?
No, I keep it in...
Data volume inside the container
itself. In this example, I put it in the data container itself because it's a LXD container.
Okay. So would you recommend like just put the data files inside the container itself or is attached somewhere else? Is it better?
If you can build a cluster database, right? If you can build a cluster database, if you build a cluster database, right? And you build up a container setup like this, then if you use a scale-out solution for PostgreSQL, then I will keep it inside the container. Every container will become part of the cluster.
Yes.
Because you don't have any performance penalty, you understand? You don't have any performance penalty because you are really using bare metal.
That's slightly dangerous, I say. The idea of a container is, for whatever reason the container blows out of the water, I recreate it from an image, and then I don't have the current data in there, so I then need to synchronize. So typically, the volume where the database data goes needs to sit outside of the container.
No, because you will... See, you will have high... What I'm talking about here is high availability cluster with your backup. You will never give up your backup. I never say you should give up your backup. This I never say no. You have a cluster, and it's a scale-out cluster. So even if one image goes wrong, let it go wrong. Still, my other clusters can balance it. Because it's a scale-out horizontal cluster, not...
Yeah, like I said, once your database gets to a reasonable size, the resync time, second cluster comes back, becomes quite substantial. So typically what you look in a large production environment, you then look, can my storage be high available? Can the storage system be high available? Like your
No, this is where I was trying to tell you is that containers. Sorry.
I think it's about time, so maybe we can close it first and then kind of.
Sure, please.
Because some other may want to leave.
Sorry. Yeah. Thanks a lot, huh? Thanks a lot for your time. Hopefully, it was something better. I don't know. what you were asking me the question, right? I checked the performance. You know, I don't go without benchmark tests, right? And my thinking was, I worked with, RAID storages. I worked with Gluster and Ceph. The problem is, the performance given by IOPS and performance given by local storage can never be compared with whatever network storage you talk about. It's very hard to get that performance. And containers can use your local IOPS. So underlying, sorry, I...